God, let's bow our heads in prayer. We're going to come before the Lord, and we're going to remember those that are sick today and pray for them, that God will visit them wherever they are. Continue to pray for Darren McElveen, of course, Brother Wesley. We pray for Cecil McKendry and Christina and Margaret Wright and David Loudon and Jim Archibald. We pray for Edna Scott and Beatrice McGarry, Patsy Doherty, and we continue to pray for Alec Robinson and Dave Boyle and Sam Bloomfield, Elizabeth McAreevy and Peter Moy and Joanne Peden. And we pray for Philip Archibald and his family, young Andrew with the cancer. We continue very much to pray for him. Lydia Moore also needs the Lord as she has treatment. Ray Laverty, and we pray for Hazel, Martin Moore and Alison McClellan. And we continue to pray for Bobby Todd. The Lord will be with him. Bobby Archibald too. Joan Hunter needs the Lord too. And we do pray for Ellen Morris, Robert Hunter, and we continue to pray for Tommy McCracken. And we continue to pray for David McKendry. Good to see David again out with us. And we pray for Philip Doak. Gillian's mother too needs the Lord. Jean Montgomery also needs the Lord. And we continue to pray for Siobhan's father. The Lord will be with them, Siobhan and Shirley's father. We pray for Ruby Thompson and Margaret Dewey. Pray for Mary Wade. Mary had a little fall and isn't all that well. We pray for her that God will be with her and bless her. Sammy Gordon also needs the Lord, and we pray for Johnny McCurdy, Quinny Stewart and Robert Gilmore. We pray for Pearl and Alfie Crawford, and Hazel, Rhonda's mother, continues to need our prayers. And we do pray for Stuart Boyd and Joan Logan, Ivor Patterson and Ruth McAleese. We do pray for those that are bereaved this morning, that God will comfort and strengthen them in their hour of grief and sorrow. We pray for the wars that are going on in various places, and we just pray that God will intervene in a mighty way. Bless the Sunday school and the teachers as they go to their classes, and we pray God's blessing upon them. We pray for the ministry of God's word, that God will bless his word to our hearts and our lives. Well, here are many, many needs, and we know that God is able and well able to undertake for them. Let's pray together. Our gracious God and eternal Father in heaven, in the lovely name of our Lord Jesus, we bow before thee. And Lord, we thank you for another Lord's Day. And this is a special day, Lord. It's the Easter time, Lord, when, Father, we know that you died and were buried and rose again from the grave. And so we're celebrating that wonderful event, Lord. Father, we thank you and we praise thee that we're serving a risen Christ this morning. Father, we bless you and we praise you, Father, that all over the country, Lord, people are celebrating, and we give you thanks and we praise you, Lord, that we here in Ballymoney are celebrating our Lord Jesus Christ. And for all that you have done and doing and going to do for us, Lord, we're so grateful to thee. Father, we thank you for Calvary. We thank you for your suffering. We thank you, Lord, for the great debt that you paid on our behalf. And because of that debt, Lord, we are free. Because of simple faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, Father, we're free. Free from the fears of tomorrow. Free from the guilt of the past. Father, I've traded my shackles for a glorious song. I'm free. Praise God, free at last. Oh, Heavenly Father, we thank you and we praise thee. What a joy it is to be free. Father, we pray that you'll bless every head bowed in your presence here this morning that have come to celebrate the risen Lord. We think of those that aren't here, Lord, and those especially that are sick and can't be here. We pray for them and we seek God for them. And we ask you, Lord, that you will touch them and heal them, Lord. This long list of people needs you. And we ask you, O God, that you will minister to them. Father, there are people in this world who have great serious needs. And we ask you, O God, that you will just visit them and undertake for them and comfort them and be with them at this time in the name of our Lord Jesus. Now, Father, we just commit all these things to you because we ask it all in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. If you're a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, this morning we do ask you to join with us around the lovely table of remembrance. The Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, he took the bread, he broke it and said, "This is my body broken for you. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you show forth the Lord's death until he come." The Lord. We're delighted to see you all this morning. We give you a very warm welcome in the lovely name of our Lord Jesus. Some announcements to make. The new newsletter is here this morning. Alison has printed it off, so you can have a copy of that as you leave the building. They're in the foyer there, please. Also, a coffee morning in Mount Calvary Pentecostal Church here. It's at 9 o'clock. To 2 o'clock on the 20th of April. So that's a little bit ahead yet. All proceeds are going towards Amy's mission trip to Africa with the mission Africa, and Jack's trip to Texas through Exodus. So let's pray for these young couple that are going away, and pray that God will indeed just bless them abundantly. If you'd like a CD of any of our services, you can have that by putting your name on the sheet at the back. And the 50p box is there too, if you'd like to contribute to that. We appreciate that very much indeed. Looking forward to this evening. It's Easter, Easter Sunday, and we're going to celebrate throughout the day, but this special service this evening where young people are taking part, the kids, the Sunday school kids, and of course the choir. So we're looking forward to a great night. So come along, not only come along, but pray about these services and pray that God will indeed bless us abundantly and bless all those that are taking part this evening. It's very important that you pray. I think those are all the announcements. We're going to turn to the Word of God now. Turn with me, please, to John's Gospel, chapter 21. The Gospel of John, chapter 21. I've entitled my message just The Easter Parade. John's Gospel, chapter 21, and we'll commence reading at verse 1. After these things, Jesus showed himself again to the disciples at the Sea of Tiberias, and on this wise showed he himself. There were together Simon Peter and Thomas called Didymus, Nathanael of Cana of Galilee, and the sons of Zebedee, and two other of the disciples. Simon Peter saith unto them, I go a fishing. And they say unto him, We also go with thee. Then went forth and entered into the ship, and immediately, and that night they caught nothing. And when the morning was now come, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples knew not that it was Jesus. Then Jesus said unto them, Children, have you any meat? And they answered, No. And he said unto them, Cast the nets on the right side of the ship, and ye shall find. And they cast therefore, and now they were not able to draw for the multitude of fish. And we know God will bless to us his precious word. Today, as we know, is Easter Sunday. And this marks a very special date in our calendar. As we celebrate the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. But if it is special to us, then it is also special, or has been made special, to the world. Those of us who are old enough to remember the song that was very popular many, many years ago, and it was called the Easter Parade. Part of that chorus was in your Easter bonnet with all the frills upon it, you'll be the grandest lady in the Easter Parade. I'm not sure if that parade still takes place in America in Fifth Avenue or not, but it was a spectacular parade, and the idea of the parade was to end up in church and to worship God. But like many other things in life, it has become so commercialized that it is the real meaning has been taken away from Easter and all about it. Easter Sunday is one of the biggest, supposed to be, one of the biggest attended days of church. Sadly, not with us. It has been noted that attendance doubles in some churches on Easter Sunday. It was so that people come when to show off their hats and their grandeur and enjoy the blessing of God. Now let's go back to the first Easter day that Jesus rose from the dead, and that was a very special day. One of the greatest stories that the Bible has ever written. One of the greatest stories in the Bible is David and Goliath. Now the odds very much on the side of Goliath, 9 foot tall, wearing a helmet, his breastplate, his shield, and sword, was a man full of anger. And there stands David, just a boy with no armor, no sword, no shield. All he had was a little sling and a few stones in his hand. And yet it worked. He killed Goliath simply because God was with him. How on earth would that ever have happened? There's a million to one chance that a stone would go through that little small part in his helmet. But it did, and it killed him because God was with him. If you were to take a bet on the contest, you would go 100% in favor of Goliath, of course. Only a fool would have backed David. And yet, wonder of all wonders, David won the victory. Just like David, Jesus didn't stand a chance against his accusers. Not a chance. The power of the world was totally and utterly against the Lord Jesus Christ. The Roman Empire was against him. The Jewish religion was against him. The system, everything was against him. Thousands of voices were shouting, "Crucify him, crucify him, away with him, away with him." They worshipped, they whipped him, they whipped the Lord Jesus. They put a crown of thorns upon his head. They mocked him, they spat upon him, they nailed him to the cross. They did everything that was cruel to my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. He hung there between heaven and earth until he died. Jesus didn't stand a chance, did he? But 3 days later, God raised the Lord Jesus Christ from the dead. The angels announced, "He is not here, he is risen," just as he said he would. The stone had been rolled away and victory had been won. He was risen. Hallelujah. And we can say that this morning. He is risen. As far as the world was concerned, nothing had changed. It was just the same. Pontius Pilate was still governor of Judea. The Pharisees and the Sadducees were still fighting. Nothing had changed as far as the world was concerned. But the world was wrong, because the resurrection of Jesus Christ did make a difference, a vast difference. The disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ, the men and women who were following the resurrection of Jesus Christ, would never, ever be the same again. Jesus Christ came to this earth, died a death that no man could have died. And yes, it made a difference. It made a difference when you and I came to know the Lord Jesus Christ as our Savior and Lord and Master. It changed our lives. It made a difference to us. We became new creatures in the sight of Almighty God. Yes, salvation also made a difference. How could it ever be the same again? Because Jesus was alive. He had won the victory over death, sin, and the grave. Paul could say, "Thanks be to God who gave us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ." People get excited when they go to hear their favorite pop band. They get excited when they go to football matches and shout and scream for their team. And the same spirit should permeate in our meetings, in our church. But it doesn't. We don't get excited. We should get excited because the Lord Jesus Christ has risen this morning. He's alive. And he's alive in my heart and in yours. The same spirit should be in this meeting. There ought to be a spirit of joy and a spirit of excitement because Jesus Christ has won. No more do we fear death as the great unknown. No more do we feel alone or of uncertainty, because Jesus Christ is alive. Now, in this wonderful story, there are three conclusions that are worth looking at. First of all, the importance of obedience. Now, as a pastor, I'm always thinking about what can we do to enhance the work of God? What can we do to make things better? Do we need a change to things? What do we need to do to bring more people under the sound of the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ? We have a great building, bought and paid for. Is this thing that we are lacking, is it something that God is pushing us to do, to get right and to make changes? We have prayed and we have sought God for many things, and yet at this moment we don't see a massive revival within the church. And many, many churches are struggling to bring in numbers, and they are trying to do youth work. They're trying to do special programs. They're deviating from the Word of God and putting on things that are contrary to the Word of God to try and bring in people. But that's not the way that it should be. We should not deviate from the Word of God. We must stand upon the Word of God. It doesn't matter about numbers. And then we go back and we read the story and we realize the only thing that matters and the only thing that's important and the only thing that God requires is obedience. Obedience to His word. When Jesus told Peter and the other disciples that went out to fish, they fished all night and caught nothing. And then Jesus came along and told them to throw their nets out on the right side of the boat and try again. And they did, and their nets were full. Why? Because they obeyed God. That happened because the disciples were obedient to God's word. You see, God didn't ask us to be good fishermen or skillful in throwing out our nets. He just says, obey me and make sure that you are on the right side of the boat. That's all. And if you do that, I'll put fish in your net. Do it my way, says God. Put the net out on the right side and I will bless you. If we honor God, do what's right and pleasing in the sight of Almighty God, God will do the rest. God will bless us. And God has blessed us beyond all blessings. Secondly, the Lord is always aware of our physical needs. These men were out all night and caught nothing. They must have been famished with hunger and very disappointed. And yet Jesus took time to think about these seven men in the boat. He looked after their physical need and he supplied their need and he fed them. Doesn't that tell us that whenever you were hungry, whenever you were hurt, whenever you were cold, whenever you were in need and lonely and sad, whatever our circumstances may be, Jesus is always there to reach out into our lives and to minister to us and to bring comfort to us. He's always there because the Word of God says that I'll never leave you, nor will I ever forsake thee. And God will always, if we are obedient to God and we honor God, God will always, always supply our needs. And He does that simply because He loves us with an everlasting love. Then the third lesson that comes from this great story of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, that Jesus doesn't ever give up. And the story that follows in verse 15, when Jesus asked Peter so many times the question, Peter, do you love me? Do you love me? The Lord hadn't given up on Peter. He kept on reminding him of his great love for him. Peter, do you love me? And encouraging him that it was important for Peter and for us to love the Lord back like he loves us. Sometimes, perhaps, we as Christians feel that we are all walking on eggshells. And if we don't say the right thing, or if we don't do the right thing, that God is going to kick us out of the boat. That's not so. But that is not true, because he is more gracious than humans, much more gracious. We're not so gracious as God is. God is always there when we do stumble and fall. He's there to pick us up and to send us on our way to serve him better. And something else that God is anxious to give us, and that is direction. He directs our path. Many times we have a very nice, neat little plan of our own, don't we all? We have a plan that we think, well, this is the way I'm going to go. We know where to fish. We know how to fish. We have all in our heads what we're going to do. Then God says, but you haven't listened to my plan. You haven't done it my way. Do you know what my direction for your life is? You see, God has a very special direction for our life, for your life, and for mine. And when we are sensitive to the Holy Spirit of a living God and in harmony with God, then we will benefit greatly. Obedience to God is vitally, vitally important. Not to do it our way. Not to do what go down the road that we think is the right way. But to be led by the Holy Spirit of God, be in harmony with God, then we will benefit greatly. We this morning are celebrating the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And when he was going away, this is what I love about this part of the story. He said that he would send a comforter to be with us, the Holy Spirit of the living God. And that's beautiful, to know that the Holy Spirit of God is dwelling within you and me, and that he'll never leave us, he'll never forsake us. He's there to lead us, to guide us, to direct us, if we allow him to do so. If we are sensitive, and we must be sensitive to the Holy Spirit of God. If you today believe the resurrection message, then it should be our privilege to go out and to tell others the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ, and to tell the people that Jesus Christ is risen. And not only that, but he lives within my heart and your heart. The Holy Spirit of God, I will send a comforter to be with you always. And here's the one verse that can lead us in the right direction and save our precious souls from a lost, guilty hell. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should never perish, but should have everlasting life. That was the gospel message then. And that is the gospel message today, right this moment. On this Easter Sunday, you need to respond to his message, to this message, and to put your trust in the risen Christ as your Savior and Lord and Master. And if you do, this will be the best Easter you have ever had. The day at Easter in 2024, when I came to know Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior and Master. Shall we pray? Our Father in heaven, we thank you again for the precious truths of God. Father, we thank you for your word that is a lamp unto our pathway to lead us, to guide us, and direct us. Oh, Father, we thank you this morning that we have the indwelling of the Holy Spirit of God within us. We shouldn't go astray. We should go by the leadings of the Holy Ghost. Father, we pray that you will teach us your ways, not our ways, but your ways, always, and that we may follow in your footpaths and in your footsteps. Oh, Heavenly Father, we thank you and we praise thee for this Easter Sunday as we celebrate the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. What a wonderful event, Lord. Father, we only know a little about it. But, oh God, we know that there was a Savior who died on the cross, gave his life's blood for us. We can say that he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities, and the chastisement of our peace was laid on him, and with his stripes were healed. Father, thank God for the day, the hour, when we passed from death unto life and became new creatures in God's sight. Father, we pray for the evening service. We look forward, Father, to the great program that's prepared. We ask you, God, that you will come down in all your might and in all your power, and that everything that we do and everything that we sing, everything, Lord, will be in accordance with the will of God. Father, we commit everyone into your care. For Christ's sake, we ask it. Amen. We're going to sing a closing hymn together. Low in the grave he lay, Jesus, my Savior, waiting the coming day, Jesus, my Lord. Let's stand as we sing.